gedaan.
We hebben dat zelf dat niet aangedaan.
Ook waar, ook waar.
Oké.
Okay. Alright.
Dus ik weet niet of jij zegt dat we online zijn, hè? Dat we...
We zijn online.
Ik denk dat wel, ja.
Er staat zo'n ding in de
hoek. Er zijn nog 0 viewers.
Geruststellend. Dat is wel geruststellend.
Ja. Ik weet niet, als je dat subiet ineens ziet groeien, dat getal, dan...
Ik heb het niet aanstaan, ik wil het niet weten.
Ah, ja, oké. Okay.
Okay, I think we can start. Can you hear me, everyone? Okay, so thank you for joining today's seminar. We have a kind of a special seminar. We have a trio seminar by Frederik, Jolien and Silke. And the reason why they're going to give a trio seminar is because they worked on the same scientific topic, but from different angles. And so to give a coherent global story. The idea was to let them give input on each on their respective fields. So the topic is about HIV wind companion interactions. And so I think the one who will start might be Silke.
Yes.
So please, Silke, you have the floor.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here, and thank you, Joris, for the introduction. So today, Jolien, Frederik, and I will give you an overview of the hydrodynamical and radiative modeling we've been doing of HIV wind companion interactions. I will start by introducing this topic and by introducing the different ingredients that we need for the hydro modeling part. Then Jolien will continue with explaining what these hydro models tell us about the HIV wind companion interactions, and we will go over some of the limitations these models experience. Frederik will end his presentation with outlining the radiative modeling part of the HIV winds with his radiative transfer code, Magritte. So let's begin with the introduction. asymptotic brains as giant branch stars or AGB stars are stars, evolved stars that are born with an initial mass between 0.8 and 8 solar masses. They are known to lose a significant amount of mass to a stellar wind, which determines the subsequent evolution of the star. So therefore, it is important that we understand these stellar winds well. The wind launching mechanism is believed to be a combination of stellar surface pulsations and dust formation. As such, these winds are typically called dust-driven. Because these winds are relatively cool and dense, the conditions in the AGB outflow and in the wind are ideal for a large variety of chemical reactions to occur, so for a large variety of molecules to form. Therefore, these winds have been recognized as key chemical laboratories and have been estimated to contribute about 85% of the gas and 35% of the dust budget of the interstellar medium. Post-AGB stars and planetary nebulae are the subsequent evolutionary phases of the AGB stars. Their observations show that only a few percent of them maintain some sort of spherical symmetry. So as you can also see in this figure here, the majority exhibits a wide range of complex morphologies. Now, this is in contrast with their AGB precursors. So about 80% of the AGB stars is thought to possess an overall spherical symmetry. To explain this morphological discrepancy, various hypotheses have been proposed. For example, rapidly spinning or strongly magnetic single stars. However, none of these mechanisms were found to be efficient enough to explain what we observe. Recent high-resolution observations of circumstellar environments of AGB stars now expose that also AGB outflows may exhibit significant aspherical structures, as you can see in this figure. So here, several AGB stars are presented, which are observed with ALMA as part of the Atomium Large program. Thanks to these different observations, a consensus is forming that the morphology present in AGB outflows is strongly linked to the presence of a stellar or planetary companion. Therefore, we also now suspect that the non-spherical distribution around of matter around the post-AGB stars and the planetary nebula develops from these small-scale structures on the AGB track. So in other words, it is now believed that it is the gravitational potential of a binary companion that is the main engine supporting the asymmetry in the wind. Now, this binary hypothesis is supported from different angles. So first of all, population synthesis studies find that the binarity rate of progenitors of AGB star is higher than 50%. When we also include planets in this rate, it reaches even up to 100%. Secondly, the hypothesis is supported by observations, as I have already shown you, and as you also can see here, but also since many planetary nebula that show these non-spherical morphologies are increasingly found to be in binary systems, as are AGB stars. Lastly, numerical simulations of companion-perturbed outflows demonstrate that these winds indeed acquire morphologies such as these spirals and these arcs that we observe, and that's also what you can see in this figure. So for the rest of this talk, we will go on about the topic of simulating these companion interactions. Now, before we go over to show you any results, I will first elaborate a little bit on the numerical modeling itself. Over the last few decades, the numerical simulations of AGB outflows have made significant progress. However, producing these models is still not an easy job. For example, such simulations come along with a lot of computational requirements and also with very high computational costs. Moreover, the parameter space of AGB binary systems to investigate is immense, and also the physical and chemical processes that are involved and thus also need to be modeled are complex. Now, from the latest observations of AGB star, it is clear that also only 3D simulations will suffice to correctly model this interaction between the wind and the companion. Generally, we can follow two different approaches to proceed this research. On one hand, we can try to model the outflow as realistic as possible by including plenty of physics. Or on the other hand, we can start by only implementing the fundamental physical processes and explore the parameter space, with then the aim to gradually build up the amount of physics in the simulation. Both these approaches have been followed in several studies already. However, for the first approach, it is very difficult or even almost impossible to disentangle the effects of the different processes on the morphology. So therefore, we have chosen to follow the second approach. So this allows us to study the fundamental effects first, and that so that we are able to explore the parameter space. The code that we have been using for our AGB wind companion interaction modeling is the code Phantom. Now, this code, Phantom, uses the numerical technique of smoothed particle hydrodynamics, or SPH in short. So now I will shortly explain you how this numerical method works. So SPH is this numerical method, and it solves the equations of fluid dynamics in a mesh-free way. So it does this by approximating the fluid as a set of discrete particles, and it follows the behavior of the properties of these particles as they interact with each other. To ensure a proper representation of the fluids, the fundamental properties, such as density and energy of each particle, are smoothed over a finite length, and this length is called the smoothing length. This length determines which neighboring particles can affect each other. The specific way in which these nearest neighbors affect each other is determined by the so-called smoothing kernel. So for example, a 3D Gaussian function would be a suited smoothing kernel. Although most often cubic spline kernels are used since they have a reduced computational cost in comparison to a Gaussian function. So as I have just told you, SPH works with discrete particles. And this makes that the resolution of a model is automatically follows mass and thus density. This implies that SPH is very well suited to model accurately compact regions and dense, so compact and dense regions. In addition, since the SPH equations are invariant to certain symmetries and geometries, most conservation laws, and more specifically the conservation of angle and momentum, are implicitly conserved. So both these main characteristics of SPH are very advantageous in our purpose. The first one, because of course we aim to model accurately the interaction region in the outflow, and secondly, because conservation of angular momentum is of course very crucial for a correct orbital dynamics. Now, our HB wind companion simulations, they contain two primary components. So first of all, we have two sink particles, and these represent the HB star and the companion. They are not subject to the SPH equations, but only interact via gravity with each other and with the other particles. Besides, we have the HB wind, and this is modeled as a gas of SPH particles. So this gas follows a polytropic equation of state, which with a polytropic index, gamma equals 1.2. This gamma is chosen because the temperature profile in HB outflows typically follows a power law. So this makes that the thermodynamical behavior of the gas lies in a regime in between the adiabatic and the isothermal extremes. Now, in order to launch an HB wind, radiation pressure and dust grains are necessary. So this implies for a self-consistent model that we need dust formation chemistry and also radiative transfer to take into account in our models. However, this is an extremely computationally expensive and also very difficult and technically difficult to achieve. So therefore, we used another approach. In order to launch an HB wind, we modified the gravitational potential of the HB star such that we can tweak its strength with a single parameter called F. This is what you also can see here in this formula. So to actually launch a ballistic wind, this F is set to 1. This technique has also already been used in the literature and has been found to be a very effective way of generating an accurate wind without the need for additional physics. The literature shows that the morphology of HB winds is sensitive to four main properties of the system. So we will look at the wind velocity, the binary separation, the eccentricity, and lastly, the companion mass. However, a consistent sweep covering the effects of these different parameters on the resulting morphology has not been undertaken yet. As such, Jolien and I have taken this opportunity to investigate this part of the available parameter space. And this is thus a work that we started last year in our master thesis, which was supervised by Wart Woman and Professor Leen de Sin. Specifically, we will investigate the following grid of models. So we varied between three different values for the wind velocity. We chose between four different values for the binary separation. We looked at circular orbits, but also at two eccentric ones. And then lastly, we compared the effect of a stellar companion and to the effects of a planetary companion, which is 10 times as massive as Jupiter.
Okay, so I will now discuss the impact of these parameters and the morphological analysis of our models. So when the HB star is part of a binary system, the morphology of its outflow will be affected by two primary effects. First, there is the induced orbital movement of both components around the center of mass. And secondly, there is the gravitational attraction of matter by the companion. The impact of the companion will be stronger if its mass is larger. Since then, the gravitational force on the wind particles will be stronger, and it will also induce a larger orbital movement of the HB star, and thereby larger orbital velocity of the HB star. And then this star will also deflect the wind stronger. Similarly, a smaller semi-major axis will result in a stronger impact, since this also increases orbital velocity of the HB star, and it will make the companion reside closer to the HB star in a region with a higher wind density, such that it deflects more wind particles. Lastly, a stronger impact, the companion will have a stronger impact if the wind velocity is smaller, since this induces a larger interaction timescale of the wind particles with the companion. So the model in which the impact of the companion is limited the most is the one with the highest wind velocity and largest orbital separation, which is shown here. So here you can see the density distribution in an orbital plane in the orbital plane slice and in a slice perpendicular to this orbital plane. The orbital plane reveals a two-edged spiral structure that is attached to the companion with a dense inner and less dense outer spiral edge. The origin of these edges can be understood as follows. If wind particles approach the companion, their path will be gravitationally deflected towards the companion. So wind particles approaching it closely from behind it will be accelerated in the direction of motion, whereas wind particles closely in front of it will be decelerated. So this is the well-known gravitational slingshot effect, and this will create a velocity dispersion in the gas flowing behind the companion. The gas particles with the largest radial velocity component will then collide with outer but slower moving wind particles, and this results in the outer spiral edge. And similarly, the inner spiral edge is formed by the wind particles with the lowest radial velocity component that collide with faster inner moving wind particles. So because of this velocity dispersion, the spiral will broaden, and after a while, the outer spiral edge will collide with the inner spiral edge that originated one orbital period earlier. And in this model, this happens after about 1.5 orbital periods, as is indicated by the white arrow. So in the meridional plane, you can see concentric arcs, which reveal the height of the spiral structure. And this especially shows that the interaction of the companion with the wind particles is manifested in three dimensions. So if we lower the wind velocity and semi-major axis, the orbital velocity of the HB star will be larger and the impact of the companion will be stronger. So here in the orbital plane, there is again a spiral structure, but this time with bicentric rings as an edge-on view. And these bicentric rings shape the morphology into an elongated peanut shape. So if you would look at this in a co-rotating frame of reference, then the orbital motion of the stars would result in a Coriolis force and an outward-directed centrifugal force, which creates this flattening or elongation. So this means that the flattening will be stronger if the orbital velocity of the HB star is larger. And this model is clearly flattened because, as you can see in the edge-on view, the arcs have reached about twice the distance in the direction of the orbital plane than they did in the direction perpendicular to this orbital plane, which was not the case in the previous model. So then we can take a look at the inner structures around the companion. And here we see that these differ from the ones in the previous model, as instead of one spiral with two edges here, one spiral flows behind the companion, and a second one originates from a bow shock in front of the companion. And this is caused by a stronger compression of the wind material around the companion, which results in a high temperature and high energy region around the companion indicated here. So these fast particles in this high energy region will then collide with wind particles that approach the companion, as indicated there. And as they collide, a bow shock is formed. Then the region of this bow shock that is located between the stars will deliver wind particles to a high density region flowing behind the companion. And the particles in this high density region can then again interact with the companion, such that the velocity and temperature around it remain high. And as this all happens in a stable way in this model, a regular bow shock is shaping a quite regular spiral structure. But then if we lower the wind velocity in semi-major axis even more, so if we increase the impact of the companion even more, a complex and irregular morphology can be formed in both the orbital and meridional plane, and even a rose-like structure appears in the orbital plane. However, the inner wind structure forming this mechanism is forming this morphology is quite similar to the previous one, but it is less stable. So again, a high energy region surrounded by a bow shock is visible here, but because of the strong compression of the material around the companion, this high energy region will be much more complex and less stable. So in this model, as the companion compresses more material around it, this high energy region will grow until it will leave the companion and propagate radially outwards, as is indicated on this slide. So this hot material will then deform the bow shock and the spiral structure that results from it. And therefore, the entire morphology will be irregular. The exact cause of this instability remains yet unclear, however. So in these models, the orbital separation orbital velocities remained about constant, which is not the case in eccentric systems. There, the orbital separation varies between its maximal value at apastron passage and minimal value around periastron passage. And then the second law of Kepler induces that the variation in orbital velocity will make the stars reside for a longer time around apastron and a shorter time around periastron passage. So this all results in a phase-dependent wind-companion interaction intensity, which induces some complexities in these models. So if we first look at a model in which the impact of the companion is limited, we see that a perturbed spiral structure results in the orbital plane, and the edge-on arcs have now become asymmetric. So the phase dependency in this system induces that the inner wind structure shaping this wind varies between a two-edged regular spiral if the companion interaction is limited, but when the companion is around periastron passage, it will compress much more material around it, and again, a high energy region delimited by a bow shock structure can be formed. So the difference between this of the variation of this inner wind structure results in a varying interarm distance in this model, and therefore low density caps arise as the ones annotated by the white arrows. This also results in so-called bifurcations, which are locations where two spirals seem to split up or come together. And these features were also already proposed in the literature to be characteristic patterns of eccentric systems. But however, due to the lack of high-resolution eccentric models in the literature, these features were poorly captured and not yet well understood. So therefore, our models provide a big leap forward in the understanding of the wind structures formed in eccentric systems. But then if we take a look at a similar model, but with a lower wind velocity and thereby stronger impact of the companion, these characteristic features do no longer arise, and instead a complex and irregular morphology is formed. So similar to the previous model, the inner wind structure will vary throughout one orbital period, and a high energy region with a post shock structure around it is created around periastron passage and is then released around apastron passage at the right side of this plot. High energy region is very complex and irregular. And this is partly because the bow shock structure here collides with the inner cold structure around the AGP star that is originated one orbital period before. But most importantly, these complex structures show that it makes sense that the morphology of this wind will be very irregular. So at last, we can look at the impact of a planetary companion instead of a stellar one by lowering the mass to 10 Jupiter masses instead of one solar mass. So we expect that the impact of the companion here will be smaller because of the limited gravitational impact and limited orbital motion of the AGB star, And this is indeed what our models confirm. So in order to optimally reveal the structures formed, we have shown the density distributions here with an other color bar, and they are zoomed in stronger. So in the orbital plane, you can see a two-edged spiral structure, but this time with a limited density contrast and limited vertical extent. But most importantly, these models show that already a massive companion can alter the wind morphology of this AGB star significantly and should thereby be taken into account when analyzing these winds. So the models we discussed here are already of great use to understand the impact of these selected parameters on the formed wind structures. And it is important that we keep developing more and improved models to get a more complete understanding of the observed wind structures. So the ultimate goal is then that we know which kind of binary systems can create which kind of observed morphologies in the winds of AGB stars as the one of the Atomium sample.
So as Jolien has now just mentioned, we still need to improve our models. So therefore, I will now discuss and go over the limitations and the shortcomings of our models, but also of the current models in general. So to give an overview of what we have been discussing so far, this scheme represents the different key ingredients that are needed to accurately and correctly model AGB wind companion interactions. So as you can see, and already know from what Jolien have told you, we need, of course, the hydrodynamics to model the wind itself, but we also need chemistry. In order to let those two interact, we need prescriptions of radiative transfer and thermodynamics so that we can go from density outputs to abundances. Lastly, if we want to make synthetic observations to compare to actual real ones, as Jolien has just said, we need to know the emission of the different chemical species that are present in the outflow, since that is, of course, what a telescope can observe. So to get those emissions, again, radiative transfer interferes. At the current stage, the AGB wind modeling community is here. So we are only just at the hydrodynamics part, as are we. However, this does not mean that our current hydrodynamical models are complete, so to say. No, also these hydrodynamical models are still limited in a number of ways. So besides being restricted by their physical runtime and their data size, we currently lack a lot of essential physical processes in our simulations. So currently, we lack decent cooling prescriptions of the gas. And it has already been proven by a few works in the past that this cooling is crucial to model certain phenomena. For example, Teuns and Jorissen simulated an AGB outflow as an isothermal gas. So as a result, the temperature of the AGB outflow stays low around the companion and stays low enough for an accretion disk to form. However, this is not the case when the wind follows an adiabatic equation of state, and therefore also we don't get accretion disks in our model, which Jolien has just discussed. Nearly three decades later, Chen et al. Included some basic prescriptions of molecular cooling, dust grain opacity, and radiative transfer in their models. And due to those additions, they found that under the right conditions, a circumbinary disk develops in the outflow. The formation of circumbinary disks, the study of it, is also very important to study it, since these disks have often been observed in post-AGB binary systems. And they have also been believed now to be able to host secondary generation planets, since they show similarities with protoplanetary disks. Now, in order to realistically and accurately model this cooling and the critical missing ingredients, we need to take two large numerical steps. First of all, we need to couple a full chemical network to the hydrodynamics code in order to model molecule and dust formation, and also to account for the presence of the heating and the cooling molecules. Secondly, we need to feed this information into a radiative transfer solver, which can then calculate the rate of radiative molecular cooling in the entire wind, and which can also work out the degree of radiation pressure on the dust grains of the wind. However, it is known that these types of calculations are computationally extremely expensive. For example, evolving a complete chemical network, this should be done at every time step in the hydrodynamical simulation. This will increase the SPH calculation time by a factor of about 50. And this will then shift the calculation time for a single model from days to months. Adding also radiative transfer to this story can easily increase the calculation time by yet another factor of at least 100. So therefore, it becomes clear that implementing these missing ingredients is not evident to do. So as you can see, we need to use new methods and develop new ways in order to proceed the modeling of AGB wind companion interactions. A way to work around this problem is to replace computationally expensive calculations with an artificial neural network that is trained to mimic the behavior of the physical, the physics and the chemistry that we want to implement. So due to all the advances in machine learning technology nowadays, current computing systems are highly optimized to handle these type of numerics. For example, specifically for the chemistry, de Miola et al. Proved that with machine learning, it is possible to emulate chemistry in order to speed up the chemical calculations up to a factor of 10 to the power 5. So therefore, it will make this feasible to evaluate a full chemical network, so in a feasible runtime. Currently, such a chemical emulator is being developed by Holship et al. So in a similar way, we now aim to develop a chemical emulator specifically set up for the conditions and the chemical reactions in the winds of AGB stars, because this will then allow us to make our 3D hydrodynamical models more realistic without unreasonable cost associated with the traditional way of calculating chemistry.
Okay, so as Silke just explained, solutions for a practically feasible hydrochemical model are in sight. That still leaves us with the challenge to include also radiative transfer. As we will see, emulation can also here help to alleviate the computational burden, but there is more that we can do. So let's briefly recap why we need radiative transfer. For hydrodynamics, radiation acts as an efficient cooling mechanism and as an additional pressure term. For chemistry, it results in photoreactions. So the radiative pressure and photoreactions are the result of the collective behavior of photons, while cooling is the result of particular lines. Cooling happens when molecules are collisionally excited to higher rotational or vibrational energy levels and then relax back to lower states with the emission of a photon. Since these energy levels are quantized, the resulting photons will have well-defined energies, causing distinct emission features or lines in the radiation spectrum. These are so narrow in frequency that they are very sensitive to Doppler shifts. As a result, there is a strong connection between the radiation field and the velocity distribution, complicating our computations. However, if we can observe and identify these lines, they encode valuable information about the composition, temperature, and velocity of the medium, making them ideal probes to study stellar wind morphologies as the ones we saw earlier. We only need a tool to perform these radiative transfer computations, and therefore we developed MAGRIT. So MAGRIT is a collaborative project between University College London and KU Leuven, including Silke, Jolien, and many others, and it aims to build a modern software library for 3D radiative transfer. But why do we want to build yet another radiative transfer solver? So admittedly, 5 years ago, there were already several 3D radiative transfer solvers available. So why build yet another one? The reason was that none of the existing solvers could provide all of the critical features we were looking for. So first of all, we needed a solver that was designed as a plugin, since our ultimate goal is to couple radiative transfer with hydrodynamics and chemistry models. And coupling codes is often not trivial. In our group, we work both with grid codes, such as AmmerVAC, which uses a hierarchically refined grid, and particle codes, such as Phantom, as we saw before. So if we want to be able to couple to both, we need a very flexible design that requires minimal assumptions, in particular about the grid structure. Then, secondly, we want to be able to leverage modern computer hardware. Our simulations are computationally very demanding. The only way to run them in an acceptable time frame is on a so-called supercomputer. Modern supercomputers are dominated by two main trends, that is parallelism and accelerators. This means we want our code to efficiently run in parallel over the multiple cores inside a processor and over the multiple processing nodes inside a cluster. Apart from regular CPUs, a modern cluster also contains accelerators such as GPUs or FPGAs, which are much faster for some specialized operations. Therefore, we also want to be able to offload our computations to these accelerators. And then finally, we require a fully benchmarked performance in terms of accuracy, computational speed, and scaling. We aim to do large simulations regarding large computational resources in which many parts of the computation depend on the radiative transfer model. So if you invest all this time and resources, you at least hope that results are reliable. And as we showed in our first paper, benchmarking Magritte against analytical results and also other codes, apparently this could not be taken for granted for existing codes. So with these requirements in mind, about 4 years ago, we started building Magritte. So how does it work? Now, the first and foremost feature is that we do not assume any type of grid structure. We use a meshless model geometry. This means that we assume a point cloud in which we know the positions of each point and also their nearest neighbors. Given this model, the radiation field is computed with a deterministic ray tracer and formal solver. This means that we trace rays or straight lines through our model and then solve the radiative transfer equation along those rays. Since we do want to do line radiative transfer, there is a strong coupling between the radiative properties of the medium and the radiation field. As a result, we iteratively have to solve for the radiation field until the radiative properties converge. So there are plenty of tricks to do this in a clever way, and I will highlight some of them a bit later on. Then, since the main contribution to the computational cost comes from the fact that the geometries that we use as input contain such an awful lot of points, we asked ourselves whether we actually need all these points for our radiative transfer computations. And it turns out that if you properly resample the remaining points, the required number of points can be reduced by about an order of magnitude without significant loss of accuracy on the radiative transfer result. So we checked this. And as you can see here, the results for an AmmerVAC model, we can drastically reduce the number of points that we use to represent the model. And we still, only at a small error. And we did a similar thing for the SPH models, where we found similar results. Okay. Then finally, all of the above is implemented in an MPI OpenMP hybrid, able to leverage both multi-thread and multi-node parallelism, as well as GPU offloading. So what does Magritte have to offer for stellar wind research? Although we've made considerable progress in making radiative transfer cheaper, we're not yet at the point where we can afford to run full radiative hydrochemical models. Nevertheless, we do have a roadmap to make that possible over the next 4 years. In the meantime, however, we can already use Magritte for post-processing hydrodynamical models and make synthetic observations. So here we see some synthetic observations sweeping through frequency space in the channel maps. So of the first rotational transition in CO for three of the models that Silk and Ayolien showed earlier. The left column shows observations along the z-axis, so viewed directly at the orbital plane. And the right column shows observations along the x-axis, so looking in the orbital plane. Given the mainly radial velocity structure of these models, the observations look quite similar to their corresponding density maps, although we can already notice some more intricate effects, for instance, in the model here. So these synthetic observations are clearly a nice way to show off these models. However, their real power comes from comparison with observations. So let's consider, for instance, this sweep through a real observation of R. aquilae, which was part of the atomium sample. This is definitely one of the most intricate morphologies in the sample. But if we compare it with, for instance, Jolien's eccentric V10A6 model, we can already notice the similar arc-like density enhancements that we see appearing here. So although the models are still very limited in physics and chemistry, they are already able to reach the observed morphological complexity and can help us understand the rich observational data. However, even for the more simple spiral morphologies, we still cannot do a proper one-to-one comparison. So what's next? How can we link those complex, computationally expensive 3D models to real observations? And how can we close this apparent gap between modeling and observations? Well, from the Magritte point of view, we see two ways to close this gap, which we codenamed Magritte 2.0 and Magritte minus 1.0. So let's start with the most obvious solution, and it is to reduce the computational burden of radiative transfer. We've already done some work in this direction, for instance, by reducing the meshes. There are still more we can do. And I would like to highlight some of our recent projects with our master students, Atelier Sirivastava and Thomas Keulemans. So in a first project, we're trying to improve ink acceleration. Ink acceleration is actually just a mathematical trick to improve the convergence of in the iterative computation of the radiation field. You can find it in every book and almost every solver for line radiative transfer. Now, we noticed that exactly the same mathematical trick goes under various different names in mathematics and computer science literature, where it's used, for instance, to accelerate training in machine learning applications. However, they often formulate this trick in a slightly different way, which makes it much more flexible and powerful to use than any implementation we've seen in any radiative transfer application. So in this project, we basically show how we can use this more modern version of ink acceleration in radiative transfer. In the same project, we also explore whether we actually have to compute the radiation field in the entire model, or whether we can just do the exact computation for, say, a fraction of the model, and then use a fancy interpolation method like Gaussian process interpolation to emulate the result on the remaining part, giving us a cheap way to get past these expensive computation. So it turns out that this gives actually pretty nice results, and you will be able to see all of it in Atelier's master thesis. Then in a second project, we're exploring the use of multigrid methods. This is somehow similar to the idea of the emulator, but applied here over multiple iterations. So the radiation field has to be computed in an iterative way, meaning that we have to compute it over and over again while the radiative properties of the medium converge. The idea of multigrid is that instead of computing the radiation field over and over again on the intricate fine mesh, that for the first iterations, which aren't exact anyway, we iterate on a much coarser version of the mesh and then gradually move to finer meshes as the solution converges. This reduces the overall computational cost, since iterations on the coarse meshes are much cheaper. The results of this work can be found in Thomas Keulemans' master thesis. And then finally, we're also looking into a truly probabilistic way to do radiative transfer that naturally allows for uncertainty quantification. A severe shortcoming of all existing radiative transfer solvers is that we have absolutely no idea about their uncertainties. We always assume their solutions to be exact and present them without error bars, while we know very well that there are uncertainties propagating, for instance, from the input data, and uncertainties due to the discretization errors in the solver. This is obviously an issue when you want to draw any conclusions from radiative transfer results or when you want to make any predictions, but it also makes it hard to push performance further since we cannot properly gauge the trade-off that we are making between accuracy and speed. So therefore, in this project, we propose a new, truly probabilistic solution scheme based on probabilistic numerics that allows to compute radiative transfer field, the radiation field, as well as its uncertainty. All of the above will be combined into Magritte 2.0, which will be a fast hybrid solver slash emulator with uncertainty quantification. Now, this will certainly help in comparing model results to observations. However, we will still need giant grids of models, and although some of these models might look similar to some observations, due to the chaotic evolution of hydrochemistry, they will never be exactly the same. So therefore, we propose to build somewhat the inverse of Magritte, codenamed Magritte minus 1.0, with the aim to model actual observations by turning them into probabilistic models. This is certainly not a new idea. Deep projection algorithms have been around for more than 100 years. And last year, our colleague Miguel Mondarget used one of them to make, for example, this nice deep projection of MuSep. However, all of the existing deep projection methods have difficulty to cope with the intrinsic ambiguity in their results, since without additional assumptions, 2D images simply cannot contain all information of a 3D model. So therefore, we propose a probabilistic approach to this problem based on image-based 3D reconstruction. And all of this we do hoping to reinstate the feedback loop between modeling and observations that is vital for scientific progress. Thank you very much. We're happy to answer any questions, and you can ask them in the comments.
really a very large undertaking. It's a complex thing, but it's very impressive. So if you have a question, you can post it in the YouTube live chats, and then I will try to read it out, and then one of the three speakers can answer. So the first one is from Abigail, who thanks the speakers, excellent seminar. And the question is the mass ratio between the central star and the companion important for the geometry of the wind structure, or is the absolute mass of the companion?
Yeah, it is indeed the mass ratio, but we just focused on the companion mass because we keep the mass of our AGP star just the same in all our models. But indeed, it is the mass ratio that is important, actually.
And this, to follow up on that, it has already been proven in a few papers before that when, for example, if you have a three solar star, solar mass star, and a similar companion, that the morphology is also complex. But if so it's really in the end the mass ratio.
Are there any other questions? If so, please post in YouTube chat or feedback comments. So we have a question from Robert Byens. He wants to know what are the disadvantages, not the advantages, but the disadvantages of the SVH methods compared to finite difference. If there are any.
Yes, there are disadvantages, of course, because that's the thing of everything. So for SPH codes, I have mentioned that the conservation laws are implicitly conserved. And this then also in turn makes that, for example, shocks and that kind of things are not well modeled just with the SPH equations itself. So therefore, we need to explicitly implement some of these shock propagation stuff into the code, because actually SPH is sort of too good and too robust to handle shocks. So those things are as explicitly implemented. That's the main disadvantage that I can think of.
Thank you. Cleo would like to know if there are other astrophysical fields that might benefit from MAGRIDS.
Yeah, definitely. So here we only show the applications with AGB stars, but of course also for planetary disk research, it would be very useful. Yeah, and radiative transfer is used all over astrophysics. So I think, yeah, it can definitely be used. So it's not definitely not limited only to AGB wind research. And I think the deprojection method that we aim to develop will also be interesting for and galaxy research, because their deprojectors are used much more often than in HB research. So, yeah.
Okay.
Plenty of use cases.
Excellent. Then there is a question of Pablo, and he would like to know if it's also possible to use MAGRIDS in 2D or 1D with a reduced computational cost then.
Yeah. So, currently, MAGRIDS only has a 3D and a 1D spherically symmetric implementation, but if I someday have some time, I am also planning to include a 2D solver in there. That's currently not available, but yeah, we can definitely do it in the future. Algorithms will be, it's easy to implement these things, so yeah, we might do that if that is necessary for some application, but currently only 3D and 1D.
Then Teresa would like to know how big the impact is of the mass ratio on the mass loss rate of the AGB star.
Yeah. So the thing is with the mass loss rate, for now we don't know yet what the impact is on the mass loss rate, because currently the SPH equations are invariant to density scaling. So this means that no matter what mass loss rate we give as an input value, this will not affect the morphology structure in the outflow. So everything regarding to mass loss still needs to be improved with, for example, decent cooling and more physics into the models. Mm-hmm. So we don't know yet what the impact will be of changing the mass ratio.
Yeah. The most important impact regarding the mass loss rate will be that the observed mass loss rates will can be wrong because there is a companion. Because if you observe the system and the density is not spherically symmetrically distributed, then there can be made wrong estimates of this mass loss rate. And then that is due to the complex morphologies that are created by this companion. So that is the main impact.
Okay, thanks. Then many people were impressed by Madrid, of course. And so if they would like to use it, should they contact you, or will it become publicly available?
Yeah, so actually Madrid is already publicly available on GitHub, but we're currently, so it's on GitHub at magritcode/magrit, but currently it's, well, there's no final release yet, so we're working on the first release of it. So yeah, we're still working on some documentation to, well, make it easier to use, but if you already want to use it, feel free to contact us and we can, we'll see how we can help you with whatever application you have in mind.
Okay, the next question is, what physics is either simplified or slow plane left out in Phantom compared to the first approach? And the first approach is one, the one where plenty of physics was included, but in the parameters.
It's also like he's going to answer your leader eye, but I'll start on this.
Yeah,
yeah, so for example, also what that I have been discussing in this talk, in our Phantom models, there is no cooling prescription. So it's only the basic adiabatic cooling that is included. So for example, the people that I have indicated in my talk, I talked about Chen et al. So they really put some prescriptions of cooling in their code. But this is not done by full chemical networks as we plan to do, but really like assuming constant abundances of some cooling molecules like H2 and some others. So for example, that's something that is still left out of Phantom. And that's, I think, the most crucial one if you compare to current literature models. But this is what we are working on, of course, and will be working on in the coming years.
Okay, good. Thanks. Then there's a question from Glenn Michael Oman. Well, it's not a question, it's a comment. He says that in certain paper by Salatino, it shows that the geometry of the outflow is mainly impacted by the ratio of the orbital versus wind velocity. You care to comment on that?
And that is indeed the case. But we simplified it a bit in this seminar by focusing just on these simple parameters. But Silke is writing a lot on that in her paper that you can soon read. So yeah, we know that this is the case, and yeah, that is true.
Yeah, so to go on a little bit on that, in my paper that I will submit soon, I indeed investigate a few parameters like this ratio of velocities to see if just from such type of ratios that we can take, we can maybe predict what type of morphology we have to see. So for example, in the paper of Saladino, there they say that we can like take the whole parameter grid just in function of this velocity ratio of the orbital to the wind velocity. But as it turns out, this is not really applied to our models, but then I refer you to my paper. So we also have been looking into this.
Okay, I have a question from Sanjay, but I'm not understanding it, so maybe I have to rephrase it. Are two stars better than one? Do you...
Uh. Yeah, they're more interesting, of course, because then these complex morphologies are there. Well, if there's just one star, then the outflow will be spherically symmetric and no structures are formed. So yeah, two stars are useful to explain the complex morphologies that we also see in post-HGB stars and planetary nebula. So that is why we model them. So yeah, they are interesting.
Okay. Meanwhile, there are several comments of people who said it was an amazing seminar, very impressive, very nice. So people really appreciated it. Are there any more questions? If not, then I would like to thank Frederik, Louis, and Silke again. Thank you very much. And maybe at some point in the future, we will have a follow-up seminar about all the things you did by then. So, okay, thank you very much, and see the rest of you next week.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.